Music is my life. Music has been my companion and my source of consolation all my life. It sustained me. That music sustained me in the hours of tragedy and facing death.
It would seem those memories of tragedy and death are a lifetime away, but this man remembers it all. And more than 60 years later, in the quiet sanctity of the Beth Shalom synagogue, Cantor Moshe Taube reflects on one of the darkest times in world history. Before the Holocaust, before the German invasion of Poland, Moshe Taube lived a comfortable life as a young boy in the Jewish section of Krakow. Then, as he is today, Moshe Taube was deeply religious and musically gifted, a gift encouraged by his mother, Regina.
She made sure that I have a musical education, that I study piano.
Moshe's father, Emmanuel Taube, owned a shirt factory.
My father did his best. He worked very hard to provide for conditions that in which I would be able to grow up and be educated to the best of their ability. My sister was a sweet little thing, a sweet girl, very docile, well behaved. Crazy sound, yelling.
Like many Jews in Krakow, the Taube family had heard Adolf Hitler speak.
Inciting the crowd to frenzy.
But never imagine what awaited them.
According to my childish perception, well, they thought that it was lots of hot air. It was just a braggadocio by a crazy dictator, which will never come to pass. Nobody believed that a nation of a Beethoven, of a Brahms, of Goethe would resort to a genocide. Nobody believed it.
After the Germans invaded Poland in 1939, the Taubes moved from place to place in hopes of avoiding the Nazis. Ultimately, they ended up in the Krakow ghetto, where Jews were packed into deplorable housing in a walled-off area separated from the rest of the city. And then the Nazis came for the Taube family.
My last image of them was when we together were herded together by the Germans to be put in cattle cars.
Moshe's mother and little sister Nina were taken away by train.
They were taken on October 22nd, 1942, to the death camp.
To Belzec in Poland, a small camp but notorious for its expediency. Guards at Belzec could murder 1,200 people at a time. Regina and Nina Taube were among them.
There, they were put in guest chambers.
Moshe and his father were sent to a work camp called Plashov.
By a miracle, myself and my father were somehow saved.
That salvation came in the form of these simple sheets of paper, now old and yellowed. Look at the name next to number 22. You'll see Taube, Maximilian. That's Moshe. And his father, Emmanuel Taube, number 24, on Schindler's list.
It is my strong belief that Oskar Schindler was an emissary from God.
The list is in the lower drawer of my desk.
Most people know about Oskar Schindler because of Steven Spielberg's Oscar-winning movie. Schindler was a well-connected German businessman who used his pull with Nazi officials to keep Jews working in his factory and out of the death camps.
He was a man of great charisma, of great influence upon his fellow Germans. And he used this influence and this charisma to make possible the salvation of the 1,200 Jews. He was also a man of tremendous good heart. He knew that we were starving and getting delirious from starvation. So he tried his best. He tried his best to organize supplies. What supplies? Bread. And bread was like gold at that time. To have a piece of bread, it was the greatest experience. He knew very well that we didn't, that there were people who were dying for a smoke among the inmates. So he used to light up a cigarette, take one puff and throw out the cigarette so that the one of the inmates should grab it or, and share it with two or three inmates.
After the war, workers on the list became known as Schindler Jews, and Schindler became known as a righteous Gentile, a term describing non-Jews who risked their lives to save Jews during the Holocaust. At the end of Spielberg's film, real-life Schindler Jews are shown at a Catholic cemetery in Jerusalem, where Oskar Schindler is buried. Cantor Moshe Taube is in the crowd. He does not know where. He has never seen the film. But what the cantor has seen is a growing interest in Holocaust history.
I'm glad to meet you.
Especially
Welcome.
In Pittsburgh schools.
I'm glad to see you.
On this day, he visits Sally Gooch's eighth grade class at St. Joseph Regional School in Port Vue. They've been studying the Holocaust for weeks, and now the students have a long list of questions.
Stephanie asked me whether I lost any hope while I was in the concentration camp. It's a very difficult question. I had great faith in the Almighty. In spite of the fact that we experienced an absence of the Almighty, like he would turn his face away from all of us, I still had faith. At one point, I was just asking the Almighty that whenever I'm put to death, it should be quick.
Questions from teenagers to a man who spent his teenage years in a concentration camp.
What was the theme between friends in a concentration camp? My age, teenager. Girls? Forget girls. Bread. A piece of bread. A piece of bread was something to dream about.
You just can't imagine it.
A piece of bread, like I was like a piece of gold.
Like I was very appreciative that he decided to come and talk to our class because I think we all really needed that after studying this.
The children have to have the conscience and the consciousness. The children have to have the information what happened in the past.
And we wanted to hear about his experience with Schindler.
Because if we do not understand the past,
we never want this to happen again.
If we do not evaluate the past,
we have to step up to other people to stop racism from happening.
If we do not make some kind of a link with the past.
And we need to know about this experience so we can prevent it from happening again.
The past can be repeated.
Very good.
Sally
Very
Gooch good. Is especially yeah, proud of the students at St. Joseph today. And they're proud of her too, knowing she's about to take their Holocaust studies to a higher level.
Is this like the train car that you were in?
I was riding. Yes, this is called a kettle car.
In the quiet time after the students are gone, this teacher at a Catholic school in Port Vue and this cantor from a synagogue in Squirrel Hill talk about their upcoming trip to Poland.
1940 to 1945.
They'll visit Auschwitz, Birkenau, and other concentration camps as part of an education program organized by the Agency for Jewish Learning here in Pittsburgh. Three Holocaust survivors and about 40 local teachers of different faiths are among those on the trip.
I'm looking forward to learning about many different backgrounds. I'm looking forward to talking to Cantor Taube and to some of the others of the Jewish faith while we're on the trip to learn more about their faith and maybe to tell them some about my faith.
And while in Poland, Sally and Cantor Taube will be among 18,000 people who recreate what is now called the March of the Living. The march is symbolic of the walk taken by Holocaust prisoners as they were herded from Auschwitz, the work camp, to nearby Birkenau, the death camp.
I'm thrilled that I get to walk beside him and listen to him tell his stories about Poland.
Those stories and what Sally and other teachers see at the Polish concentration camps will come back to Pittsburgh classrooms.
My teaching will be more emotional than it has been. I know that I will probably shed a few tears in front of the kids when I relate to them the stories that I learn from the survivors that are going.
Survivors like Cantor Moshe Taube, who, for the first time, will visit Belzec, the camp where his mother and sister were murdered.
Their memory and their martyrdom never left me for one minute. I'm always thinking about them.
He already said he'll be singing. I want to learn the prayers of the dead. I want to hear him chant his prayers. I want to live that.
I'm going to bring not only memories, but a report that I was part of a memorial to our brethren and sisters who perished in those death camps, that I had the honor to memorialize them and to sing in their memory.
Great.